CFO Studio is sponsored by Real Estate Strategies Corporation, advisors to CFOs, management, and boards of directors in the acquisition and disposition of leased and owned real estate. Visit us online at realstrat.com.
You're watching CFO Studio, and I'm your host, Andrew Zezas. I'm joined today by Mr. Paul Mallen, Executive Vice President and Chief Financial Officer, Amalgamated Life Insurance Company. Mr. Mallen holds an MBA in Finance and International Business from NYU Stern School of Business and a BBA in Accounting from Emory University. Paul is a CPA, and his background includes over 25 years of experience across a wide range of industries and in various corporate finance activities, including transaction advisory services, capital structuring, and credit and financial analysis. Paul has held positions at FTI Consulting, Deloitte & Touche, and Citibank, and joined Amalgamated as its CFO in 2005. Based in White Plains, New York, Amalgamated Family of Companies has its roots dating back to 1943, when Amalgamated Life Insurance Company was founded to provide for the financial well-being of working men and women. Today, Amalgamated Life offers a broad range of insurance solutions, including group life, disability coverage, accidental death and dismemberment, medical stop-loss insurance, and voluntary benefits. Through the company's affiliates, it offers third-party administration for self-funded health and welfare funds, pension funds, medical cost management, printing services, mainframe computer outsourcing, and property and casualty brokerage. Paul is here today to talk to us about a very interesting topic entitled Today's CFO, a primary driver of corporate strategy and key initiatives. Paul, it's so nice to have you here on CFO Studio.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Paul, you've had a very, very dynamic career. You've been Amalgamated CFO now for 7.5 years. You've been through two CEOs. That says a lot about you, and it also says a lot about your company, especially at a time where mid-market and large-market CFOs are expecting to be in transition every 14 to 22 months. Based on that experience, share with me, if you will, your view of how the CFO's role has evolved in terms of corporate leadership.
CFO used to be pretty much responsible for financial reporting and constantly looking at, you know, the past, are the numbers right, and that was pretty much it.
Real rear window type.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, CFO has a lot more responsibility. It has to be strategic thinking, forward thinking, analytical, but also needs an operational bent to it. You know, there are certain advantages a CFO has compared to many financial, or not financial executives, but many executives, in the sense that CFO is being responsible for all the financial information in the company. You have to understand what drives it. Mm. Therefore, you learn the operations, and you understand what impacts the business. Mm. I look at my situation at Amalgamated, where I've been fortunate enough to grow with the company. And I started out primarily responsible for that in that financial reporting function. But over the 7.5 years or so I've been there, I've picked up increasing responsibilities. So now I'm ultimately responsible for IT, underwriting, policy services, our eligibility department, facilities. So, you know, with that obviously comes more responsibility,
sure.
Different way of thinking, more decision making. So I would say with respect to your question, you know, with increased operational and, you know, strategic responsibilities, the role has clearly naturally evolved in terms of corporate leadership.
Well, you've proven a fundamental belief that we hold here at CFO Studio, that a good CFO, especially at mid-market and large-market companies, is really a COO in terms of the diverse skills that he or she has to apply to his company. It sure sounds like you're heading in that direction.
Well, that's exactly right. And especially in smaller companies, you know, mid-sized companies, they don't have the luxury of being able to hire a COO.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. So As the CFO's role evolves, how closely should CFO and CEO be aligned?
I would say they have to be aligned. They definitely need to be on the same page, and they need to be aligned. And the roles really complement each other. You know, I've been fortunate enough now for the last 5 years or so to work for Dave Walsh, our CEO, who has this open door policy, I'd say. You know, he's constantly looking for my viewpoints, you know, whether they differ from his or not. And, you know, it's important from my perspective to be able to express those views, because at the end of the day, you know, we're a team and we're looking to do what's best for the company. You know, in terms of alignment, you know, once a decision's made, whether you agree with it or not, you know, it is what you fall in line, for lack of a better term, right?
Sure. The buck has to stop somewhere.
The buck stops somewhere, and then you focus on execution and you move on to the next issue.
So it sounds to me like you and Mr. Walsh, you have a pretty dynamic CEO and one who understands the relationship between CEO and CFO, because I think you'll also agree that while the CFO and CEO need to be aligned, even if the CFO gets that, it's really the CEO who has to permit it, and not all of them do.
Well, that's right. But, you know, I view it, I mean, to use the old cliche, there's no I in team. You know, you can't do it by yourself.
Yeah.
So the same way I expect my direct reports to express their views, you know, whether they agree with me or not, I would hope, you know, my CEO would do the same.
Sure.
And in this case, he does.
Sounds like he has. Yeah. Sounds like he has. Let's talk about profits, that wonderful term, profit.
Sure.
Paul, share with me your views of the steps that companies are taking in the current economy, and in the previous economy, I should say, to maximize gross profits.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, essentially, in my view, it shouldn't really matter on the economy. You know, you always want to increase sales and reduce costs.
Right.
I mean, it's simple basics here. But one thing we won't do, and in terms of our company, and you mentioned them before, you know, our insurance company, third-party administration, printing business, medical cost management, we won't increase our sales, though, at the cost of profit or even at a loss. We've run into situations where we know competitors are way underpricing and are taking on business at a loss. We won't do that. It doesn't make sense to us, and that's not in our culture at our company. So, you know, it's clearly to increase profitable sales. On the operating cost side, you know, there's a few things we do and that other companies do. We have a very disciplined budget process, and that's obviously very important. But one thing we've done in the last 4.5 years, we've invested significant amount of money in technology and good people who can think analytically and help with the business. And I use this as an example, and you know, it sounds like that's an increase in cost, but it really helps reduce over time. And the example I use is with respect to our call center. We created a new call center about 4.5 years ago, and we hired someone from the outside who's done an excellent job setting it up. And now, while we have metrics we can understand, we know we've increased our metrics and our performance significantly in terms of average speed to answer, well under a minute, first call resolutions, well above 95%.
Wow.
So what happens in that case is customers aren't calling back 2, 3, 4 times.
Yeah.
So now, over time, you can reduce your costs through attrition. And not only do you have a better, happier customer, which helps then on the sales side, right?
Sure.
And you have metrics you can pitch, but it also helps reduce costs. You know, and I would say the third thing, you know, in this area of maximizing profits is the culture of the corporation. We've really focused over the past, you know, 4, 5, 6 years to embed a culture in the company to keep their eye out on costs. So even though we go through the budget process, and even if a department may have certain costs in their budget or allowed to spend certain things, you know, we want that department manager to be thinking, okay, it may be my budget, but do I really need it anyway? Maybe I can hold off on you know, this item.
What I'm hearing from you is that as it relates to gross profit maximization, as CFO, you have evolved from the role of financial manager to finance leader. And it sounds like, you know, you're empowering everybody in some respect to almost be a CFO.
That's right. I mean, it's hard to do it by yourself, and people need to be part of that decision process.
Sounds like it works. Let's talk about metrics, because it sounds like you were going in that direction. You know, you're talking about how the company is performing better. You know, we've got a very funky economy right now, and what I'm interested in knowing is your view on which metrics either have emerged or will emerge as key performance indicators for private companies.
For private companies, okay. Well, every company is different, and every company is going to have different metrics. I mean,
but there are some general.
There are some general ones there. I mean, obviously, in our case, we're not looking at inventory, so we're not keeping metrics around inventory.
Right.
But, you know, in terms of private companies, you know, a lot depends on the ownership and the board point of view, what you need to manage the company. But I would say generally, sales growth, profit growth, and increasing profit margins.
How about at Amalgamated?
At our company, we look at a lot of different metrics in terms of financial and operational. I mentioned a couple with the call center in the last question. You know, in terms of some more operational, we have a medical claims paying business, and we're constantly looking at claims paid, you know, under 15 days, between 15 and 30 days, and over 30 days, and we manage the business that way. We look at our auto adjudication rates, which is basically claims that go through the systems that aren't touched by a human being. So the higher that rate, the lower the cost.
Sure.
On the financial side, you know, we clearly look at sales growth. We're looking at operating margin, profit growth, things of that nature. And, you know, as an insurance company and with the insurance company as well, we have to look at our loss ratios, which is, you know, how much benefits we're paying compared to our net premium, as well as our risk-based capital.
So it's apparent that Amalgamated is very, very focused on metrics, and it sounds like you've got some very precise KPIs. Very, very interesting way of running your company. Let's talk about the financial executive for a moment. There's been a lot of talk about the evolution of the finance executive and the CFO in particular, but as it relates to value to a company, is a CFO more valuable as a specialist or being, you know, multidisciplined?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Good answer.
Both.
Both. Well, I think every CFO has their specialty, whether they came up on the accounting side or the finance side.
That's correct.
I mean, that's
a good one anyway.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, that's the nuts and bolts and the basics. But I think the CFO, as we talked about before, you know, they have to start to understand the business. And they, to be effective, got to know the business. You have to understand the operations, where the company's heading. Be part of that, you know, in the decision process where the company is heading. So there is that, if you want to say, generalist bent to it. If there's specific things the CFO needs to learn, I mean, before I came to Amalgamated, again, I use this as an example, I didn't know anything about insurance companies. I was never involved in the industry. So you get in, you learn it, and you become effective at it. And when you need certain specialty or expertise, you know, you try to learn it on your own. You hire a consultant to help you out, or you hire, if you need someone permanently, you hire an employee to take care of that.
So foundationally, CFOs, you're saying, should be multidisciplined. They, in most cases, have their own area of skill or expertise. If they need more, they are either capable of learning, if they're any good, or they can hire it.
That's right.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes a lot of sense. So, Paul, 7.5 years in the same company as a CFO, you got to like what you're doing. What do you enjoy most about it?
It's a challenge every day. There's something new every day. Love going in and working with the people.
Enjoy the people?
Absolutely. If you don't like the people you work with, it makes going to work every day very difficult.
Sure.
So there are a lot of good things about going into the office every day.
I have time for one last question before we
before
we close. When I was in your office, I saw a really cool photo of you on an aircraft carrier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it was recent. So tell me about that.
Do we have an hour?
Well, no, we got a few quick moments.
Okay, so just real quick, about 4 years ago, I was fortunate enough to attend a leadership course where there was a four-star admiral.
Oh, wow.
And he's now the chief of naval operations, which is pretty impressive in and of itself.
Wow.
Anyway, he invited the class out. The Navy runs some programs, and he invited the class out to an aircraft carrier while it was at sea. So I had the opportunity to fly out to the Harry S. Truman while it was off the coast of Florida, do an arrested landing, spend 24 hours on the ship, be on the flight deck, which is pretty awesome as they're launching and recovering aircraft. But you know, one thing that was really interesting about it, got to spend a lot of time with the sailors, with the men and women, enlisted personnel all the way up through the senior officers, and they are impressive people. The sacrifices that they make, the working conditions that they're in every day, and the positive attitudes that they have, just incredible. So it was a great experience. When the trip ended, we were in the aircraft and we were catapulted off the aircraft carrier.
Wow.
Great fun. And,
but you were in a plane when they catapulted you off.
Fortunately,
okay,
yes.
Good. It's always a good thing. It's always a good thing. Wow, I can only imagine what that experience must have been like.
Something I'll never forget.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. Well, Paul, listen, you've been wonderful. I want to thank you for appearing with us on CFO Studio and sharing your views with us. And I'd like to wish you continued success and invite you to come back and see us again sometime.
Would love to. Thank you very much.
It's been wonderful.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
This is Andrew Zezas, your host at CFO Studio, with Paul Mallen, Executive Vice President and Chief Financial Officer of Amalgamated Family of Companies, saying thank you very much for watching. We'll see you again.
The CFO's Guide to Understanding Corporate Real Estate Transactions is packed with almost 200 pages of insightful real estate acquisition and disposition strategies. Request your free copy online at cfostudio.com. CFO Studio is sponsored by Real Estate Strategies Corporation, advisors to CFOs, management, and boards of directors in the acquisition and disposition of leased and owned real estate. Visit us online at realstrat.com.